Well, good to see each and every one of you. I'm glad to be back. I was back actually Monday and Sunday night and got to teach ladies Bible school or Bible class on Tuesday. We had a great time. Ladies, keep being faithful. We're almost halfway through. It's been awesome. It's been wonderful. Let me give you some good news. Colton and Kayla had their little girl just a little while ago, 5 pounds and 8 ounces. And 19 inches long. And I got done just before they had the baby, had prayer, then I left, and they had the baby just a little bit after I left. And they named it, the name's in Philemon. I'm going to read it to you. And then I'm not preaching out Philemon, but I just thought I'd tell you the name. I probably don't pronounce it right. Somebody might help me. Go to Philemon, too. So, Philemon, verse 2. Would you do that, anybody? And help me a little bit here. And to our beloved Aphia? Aphia, is that right? Isn't that close? So it's Aphia, Rain. I wanted to say Rain, but I thought my text said Rain, O'Brien. And we're thankful for him. She went through a lot of labor, but she's doing good now. And thank God for him. And you pray for Kayla also. And thank God for the baby. And by the way, this is Colton's birthday. Baby was born on his birthday. Isn't that something? That's good. But that's not what I'm preaching on. I want you to go with me to the book of Jude. To the book of Jude. I want you to go over there. And I am going to start a series tonight. And I'm gonna preach through the book of Jude. I'll tell you why I'm preaching this series. A couple of reasons. God told me to. But I had an evangelist friend, Brother Dale Vance. He's a good friend of mine. And we're talking about this subject here. And he said, I'd like to hear you preach it. And one of the reasons he wanted me to preach it, because I have been at this now for 47 years. And a little bit of what I say has some weight to it. And somebody's got to take a stand. Amen. And because there's a lot of folk following the pattern of the book of Jude, and I want to try to deal with it tonight, let me give you the series title. It's entitled The Apostate Fouls. I'm going to talk about apostasy. That's the theme of the book of Jude. And tonight, lesson number one, I'm going to talk about fighting for the faith. Yeah. See, a lot of you probably take for granted what you have at Taze Valley Baptist Church.
Amen. Come on, Pastor.
Come on now. You do. You do. Because, see, you really haven't been fighting for the faith. It takes a man of God with people praying for him to fight for the faith and protect the church from things that would divide it and destroy it. Somebody help me preach. So let's look at the first four verses. And we'll preach a little while tonight. I'm trying to look up the clock. I see it. Jude, the servant of Jesus Christ, and the brother of James, to them that are sanctified by God the Father, and preserved in Jesus Christ, and called. That's some good preaching right there, and I'm going to preach it in a minute. Mercy unto you, and peace, and love be multiplied. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation. So when he had his pen, he was getting ready to write about the common salvation. He said, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. And verse number 4, and we'll end the reading here. For there are certain men crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness, and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Our Father, help me to preach like I've never preached before. Help me just expound this passage. I want our folks, every one of them in this room, to appreciate what they have and want to fight and contend for it. And don't let their kids ever get into anything else other than what we're preaching tonight. And we'll praise you and honor you in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen. The book of Revelation is the last book of the Bible. And Jude is the next of the last book of the Bible. There's only 25 verses, but I want all y'all to know they're power-packed verses. See, how many agree with me that the Bible teaches us that we ought to be anticipating the Lord Jesus coming again? Amen. That's the book of Revelation. But Jude, his theme is talking about the characteristics of the days just before the coming of the Lord Jesus. We ought to know what's going to happen just before he comes. Amen. And what Jude does, Jude explains what you're seeing before your eyes every day. Somebody help me preach. See, the Bible said in 2 Timothy, in the last days will be perilous times. How many believe we're there? Come on now. The Bible said in 1 Timothy 4, now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of the devil. That word depart, if you look at the English word, we get our English word apostasy. The example is like a divorce where people fall apart or depart from one another. And there's some folks that have departed from the faith, that have left the faith, have infiltrated and trying to drag people with them. Yep. Yes. Am I preaching? Yep. Now I want to make a statement here. Here's where Dale and I talked a lot about. But maybe you'll agree and maybe you won't. But I think I'm right. I believe an apostate is a lost person. Somebody help me. And this little book of Jude gives us a guide to the apostate fowls. You know what Paul said in Acts 20? For I know that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. Also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. I want y'all all to know this. I'm hoping God keeps me here just as long as I can be here. Because I want you to know something. As long as this old man's here and is breathing air, you can count on something. I'm fighting the fight. I'm leading the church right. I'm going to be doctrinally pure. I am going to preach the word of God. Somebody help me. And what we're doing now with these young preachers, what I'm doing with them, I'm pouring myself in them. When this old man dies, I'm expecting them to stand like I stand. Somebody help me preach. See, in the last days, there's two things the devil's going to try to do to you and our churches. he's got two things he'll do. He'll attack from the outside. And that's persecution. And by the way, you leave it to the bunch of liberals. Hey, if a liberal gets in this next presidency, you just watch and see what happens.
Amen.
If Bernie Sanders gets in, we might not even have church. And I don't trust the rest of them either. I mean, that crowd, man, I've never been so sick. I know somebody's going to get mad at me, but all right, it's okay. I don't give a flip. And I watched one of them debates for 5 minutes and watched the end, and I saw one of the candidates kiss his husband. That made me enough to change my politics. Somebody help me. By the way, I'm an independent. That's why I can ruffle both you Republicans and Democrats. Somebody help me preach. But you mark it down. We are going to be attacked more and more and more and more as the day appears. Good preaching, Reverend. And then here's another attack. Not only attack from the outside in the form of persecution, but we're going to have an assault from the inside in the form of perversion.
Yep.
Beware of false prophets which come in sheep's clothing. Come on now. I do not believe that this church will ever fall from persecution from the outside. I don't believe it. We've been persecuted. Your preacher's been persecuted. Several years ago, some of these people in this community brought some nonsense up and wanted to have a big crusade at Hurricane High School, an ecumenical crusade, had the Catholics and Lutherans, the whole crowd, and they came up and gave me a public invitation. And they said, we want you, your church is the largest one in the county, we think you would really make a boost to it, would you do it? And I said, no.
Amen.
You say you didn't pray about it? Well, Lord, no, I didn't pray about it. I ain't praying about nonsense. I got more important things to pray about. Sure, I ain't praying about nonsense. I know how I'm going to act before it happens. I ain't going to do that.
Amen.
Good preaching, Reverend. I mean, they went down there, man. I want to tell you what. People come to altar and a Catholic priest deal with them. Well, he ain't got a clue how to lead somebody to Christ.
Amen.
Boy, it's quiet in here now. You say you're going to get some hate mail tonight. Well, listen to me, ladies and gentlemen. I get it all the time. It don't matter to me. I'm too old. I'm almost senile. I don't even care. Now, let me give you. I knew I was going to get stirred up. This little preacher man, wasn't he good tonight? And ain't no wonder he's good. He's practiced four times. He was up at the office. I called him and wanted to talk to him. Couldn't get a hold of him for 15 minutes. He was out practicing preaching. Came down here today and practiced down here. Evidently, did you do a dry run jump? By the way, son, one of these days you'll get old enough to be smart enough not to do that. And if you think I'm jumping off this thing, now a lot of people worry I'm going to fall off of it, but I ain't going to jump off of it. How about to help me? Now, let me give you three things. Are you following me in the Bible? First of all, I want you to notice the introduction in verse number 1 and 2. Jude, the servant of the Lord Jesus. That word servant means bond servant. That is a servant who could be, who is a willing slave that is going ahead and being a servant, even though he don't have to be a servant. Woo! Now, mic this down somewhere. He's the half-brother of Jesus. Now you said, can you prove that? Mark 6:3 and 1 Corinthians 15:7. He's the half-brother of Jesus and also the half-brother of James. Somebody help me preach. But notice something that I like about this. He didn't mention he was Jesus' earthly half-brother. See, some of y'all, you would be the first one to raise your hand, boy, Jesus' half-brother. No. He said, I'm a servant. I want all y'all to know something. When I'm out of here, I don't even care if they remember me always as a pastor or evangelist, but I do want them to remember me that I was a servant of Jesus, that I served God with gladness, that I serve God in humility. Hey, you know what's missing, Brother Jeremy? We got too many of us think we have arrived and we have lost our humility and we have forgotten that we're all sinners saved by the grace of God.
Amen.
Good preaching, Reverend.
Amen.
Oh, how many of y'all know this? Let me ask you if you know this. Do you know what Jude is short for? You know his name actually would have been? Judas. Jude is short for Judas. Now, I believe in God's sovereign plan. He had this figured out. Because his whole message is about apostates. And he had a name of one of the first apostates, Judas Iscariot. And he preached about apostasy. Now let's look who he addresses. Those that are sanctified by God the Father. The word sanctified means to be set apart. When God saved you, you were set apart once and for all by the blood of Jesus. That brother back here I met today that got right Sunday and got everything right about salvation insurance. I want you to know something. When you got saved, inwardly, you were set apart, and that cannot be changed. Somebody help me preach. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, you know who's addressing tonight? He's addressing you. You're the set apart one. You're the sanctified one. You're set apart for his glory.
Amen.
Now, notice this. And somebody help me. And preserved in Jesus Christ. That means God's guarding us carefully. For I know in whom I believe. And I am persuaded that he's able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. I want every one of you to look. Hey, sir, you just got right and got knowledge. I want you to know something. I want to teach you a little something. You're saved forever.
Yes,
you can't be lost.
That's right.
You're preserved. You're preserved. Somebody ought to raise your hand. Thank God that you're guarded. You're sealed. You're protected. You can't go to hell because you've been washed in the blood.
Amen. Yes, sir.
Preach on. Well, I know. Oh, I get a lot of hatred about this doctrine. Oh, yeah. Boy, the Armenians, they wear me out. Oh, you're the type that believes that you can believe, you can live any way you want and still go to heaven. No, we don't believe that. We believe we're so saved that we want to live for God. You're the one that every fall you get saved again, and then in the summer you backslide again and get saved about 25 times. You've been baptized so many times the frogs know you by first name. Not me, boy.
Yep.
One Lord. One faith. One baptism.
Amen.
I've been saved once.
Amen.
Woo. Then he said, called. I want you to know something. I still believe if you get saved, you got to be called to get saved. You got to get under conviction. You know why there's a lot of false, you know why there's a lot of false people tonight? Is because they haven't failed under Holy Ghost conviction. Salvation more than sign the card, more than join the church, more than get in the baptistry. You're going to fall out to sea and see yourself a sinner and get saved.
Amen.
All right. The introduction, I'm still wanting. Then he had a threefold greeting. Boy, I like this. Look at his greeting in verse 2. Are y'all there? First of all, he said, mercy. That's the upper look. You know what mercy is? Mercy is not getting what you deserve.
Amen.
Now, how many been around me enough to know I'm about half crazy sometimes? I have taught in Christian school, Bible class, and taught some Bible history. And I was known as kind of a disciplinarian, strict. And I walked out of class one day, and I did it on purpose. I just wanted to see how, I gave them something to read, and I walked out, and that whole outfit was carrying on. See, I went to the door, and I just peeked in. And I threw the door open. I said, what are you doing, outfit? And I'll tell you what I done. I said, I'm going to decide what I'm going to do to you. I want all y'all to build. I'm going to stay in the middle and want all you get around me, get on your knees, get ready to pray. You said, you're kidding me. Oh, yeah. I got the whole outfit around me. I was right there, and man, I was ready to let them have it. Boy, one of them prayed, I'll never forget. He said, help me quit acting like the devil. And one of them prayed, Lord, I love Pastor Smith. And I know he's going to do the right thing. And another one prayed, me too, Lord. And I said, get up, outfit. All of you deserve to be kicked out of class. But I'm going to show you mercy. How many could raise your hand tonight and are glad that you did not get what you deserved? That you did not, well, glory, you did not, whoop, 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 you did not get what you desired, you got mercy.
Amen.
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 Amen. And that ain't all. See, that's the upward look. Then he said, peace. That's an inward look. You know what it happened to me when I got saved? I got a peace that passes all understanding. Can I tell you, the battle between me and God, it's over. Somebody help me. I'm at peace with him. He's not going to send me to hell now. I've been washed in the blood. Jesus made peace by the blood of his cross. If you're here tonight and lost, you don't have that. Then look what he said. Mercy unto you and peace. And listen here. And love be multiplied. Love is the outward look to our relationships with him and with others. I saw an enemy the other day. I know he's my enemy. He hates my guts. But I love him. I love him. I love him. I spoke to him. I think he about dropped his teeth. I think he killed him. I think he about had an epileptic heart attack. if that's possible. And I just went by and said, how you doing, man? Hey, listen to me. I got something when I got saved that transformed me. When I got saved, I had a lot of meanness in me. And I had a little bit of prejudice in me. But I want you to know, you ever get Jesus on the inside, it changes everything. You love people you think you can't love. Somebody help me preach. And you know what he does? You know what he was saying? I want you to give them love, but I want you to give them multitudes of love. You know why we need multitudes of love? It's because we are faced with a lot of people that are not very lovable, but God wants us to love them anyway. All right, number two. Oh, man. Look at verse 3. I want you to notice the explanation. Notice what he said. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation. Here's what he was going to do. His book was going to be about the doctrine of salvation. Our common problem, which is sin. All sin that comes short of the glory of God. And our common provision, which is the blood of Jesus. Now, get down in a little squat. What? No, no, you don't have to get down. Get like you're getting ready to wrestle.
I never wrestled.
Okay. See? One, two, three. Now, I want y'all all to know. Is my face red? Yours red? I just now strained myself. That's what he's talking about, that intense verb. We're in a battle. Whew, glory. To where we got to give everything we got to fight this battle. You all right? I'm not. See, listen, we are to fight for the faith, not the faith. This is not about your personal faith. This is about the truth of the Word of God. Amen? Amen? What are you laughing about, Grizzly? You're next. Then he said, delivered. Now, means to pass or hand over. Now, here's what. No more fighting. Here's what I'm trying to do in your life. I'm trying to deliver you something that you'll fight for.
Amen.
Because you'll believe it's worth fighting for.
Amen. Amen.
Now, there's some things ain't worth fighting for. The color of that carpet ain't worth fighting for.
You're right.
I remember down in Georgia, a church split. And I'll tell you what they split. Actually, it split twice. First time it split, they had an argument in a business meeting over what color the carpet would be. There's people wanted dark blue, and some wanted white blue or light blue. The pastor got about half mad. And while they weren't looking, took all the seats out, put a seam right down the middle, light blue that side, dark blue that side. When they come Sunday, they had a light blue and a dark blue. He said, you satisfied now, idiots? Now, how many thinks that's ignorant? Ain't nobody ought to fight for something like that. I remember also a story. People fight over anything. There was a church in Georgia also. I think people in Georgia is crazy. There was a pastor who was a guy like me, believed in whosoever will can be saved, and he had a hyper-Calvinist associate. But the pastor, he got sick and tired of the associate. Associate, every time at the church picnic, would get up and he'd get a chicken leg. He'd sit through the sovereign grace of God And by God's sovereignty, it's preordained that I eat this chicken leg. And one day the pastor got sick up and jerked the chicken leg out of his hand and ate it himself. Church split. How many believe that's crazy? Why are we fighting about preferences and goofy stuff when the doctrine of Christ is at stake?
Amen.
We say 15. Whew. I'm not all right. I got to quit. I just got to find me a landing spot. What's the faith? Virgin birth? How many believe that's the faith?
Amen.
Bodily resurrection of Christ? How many believe that's the faith?
Amen.
How many believe we ought to fight for the inspiration of the scripture?
Amen.
Now I want you to know something. I'm going to stop right here. There's a group of my brother makes a statement like this. They say they're my brother. I start to worry about them sometimes. Well, I believe the Bible is inspired in the original. Now, don't that sound profound? Don't that sound profound? I believe it's inspired in the original. There's only one problem.
Yeah.
You know what it is, Jared? They don't have an original. There ain't no such thing as one now.
Amen.
We have most ancient copies. We got trusted copies. And let me ask you this question. This is where your faith stands. Forever is thy word settled in heaven.
Amen.
Now I want to ask you a question. If God said it's settled forever, then how can you tell me that we can't have a version that is right now? Now, I want you to explain it to me. You mean to tell me that I need to tell everybody here you can't count on your Bible? You can't in the original. How many of y'all seen one of them? I want you to know that Bible, that King James Bible, is the preserved word of God.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
It keeps the inspiration.
Amen.
The infallibility is all found in that book. And if that's not true, we ought to fold our tent and go home.
Amen.
Amen. Good for
you. And I want y'all to know, I got to quit. I got one more point. But can I start? Well, my sermons are like soap operas. They can go on next week. I want you to know something. This right here is the first thing the apostates leave when they leave the ministry.
Amen. You're right. That's right.
And I don't want to upset you. You say, well, I like the NIV. Well, I want you all to know something. The same place the Jehovah Witness Bible was translated from, the New World Translation, your NIV was too. Am I right? Boy, it's quiet in here. I'm telling the truth. And we got to contend for it. And if we can't start with the foundation of the Word of God, we'll never go past that door back there. And by the way, your salvation's not real to you if you ain't got a Bible that you can go to, that you can count on, that said, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. I'll get point three next week and start on into the next portion. Because on next week, I'm going to talk about apostates then and apostates now. That's next week's lesson, but I got to finish point three. Is that okay? Everybody at peace with me? Bow your head with me. How many of you believe Bible and God's word and the doctrines of faith worth fighting for? Raise your hand.
Amen.
Amen. How many right now know if you died tonight, you know you'd go to heaven? Raise your hand. Thank you. How many not sure you're saved? You're not confident. If you die tonight, you're not confident because your faith's not really built on the Word of God. You're just not sure why you're what you are. How many right now are not sure if you die tonight, you'd go to heaven? If you're not sure, raise your hand. Anybody? How many right now say, Preacher Smith, I've been saved, but I'm backslidden. I'm not living where I should, and I want you to pray for me. Would you raise your hand? God bless that hand. Stand with me. I think everybody's saved, it looks like. And I'm just going to pray. And if you want to pray, you can, but I'm not going to give a long invitation. Everybody saved. I'm teaching. Father, thank you for the word of God. But we have a verse, Lord, where somebody needs to pray about something, somebody needs to come, let them come right now. In Jesus' name, amen.